also answer that, Councillor Nicholas, and Councillor McKinley also as well. And apart from that, I think we've got a full house.
Yeah, can we record our best wishes to Ron, who's suffering from pneumonia, I believe? Can we record those?
Yeah, of course we can, and obviously both Gillian and Patrick have also got health ailments that they've gone to Suffolk and attended to today, so we're going to send our very best wishes to all of those. And it'd be remiss of us not to mention that also Natalie is a nurse, and because of her work commitments in regards to that, that's why she can't be here today. So all some very good, solid reasons for non-attendance. Second item is declarations of interest, so that's just the usual from me, reminding anyone at any time, if there's anything they do need to declare, please don't hesitate to say so. And then the third item is the minutes of the last meeting from the 2nd of February. If I can move those as a correct record.
Agreed.
That's agreed. It's superb. I'll put my autograph on those recordings. And then into the main part of the business, obviously our next item, we're very fortunate today to have Leo Goodwin, who's the Managing Director of TransPennine Express, here today, who's going to give us an update presentation about where TPE are up to with regard to services in the Liverpool City region and beyond, and particularly with a key focus on the new franchise that started last year and had it on to go. So Leo, welcome. Over to you.
Liam, thank you very much, and thanks for the invitation to come speak to you all today. It's really a timely moment to give you an update on what TransPennine Express is doing. We're just coming up with a 1-year anniversary of our new franchise, which got underway at the beginning of April last year. And so hopefully through the course of this presentation, I can give you a feel for what we've already accomplished, but more critically, what we've got to look forward to over the next couple of years as we set up on our mission of delivering transformation in our offer to our customers. So really, this presentation covers three areas. I just want to start with a piece about the root of our vision and really what we're striving to achieve with TPE. But more critically, what is the detailed plan for realising that vision over the next few years? So starting out with the North, we're all proud Northerners. We all believe in the North and its potential. And we've got lots of assets and resources as Northerners on which we can build. We've got a great tradition for innovation, creativity. We actually gave the world the notion of the intercity railway, the Liverpool Manchester Railway. It's the first intercity railway anywhere in the world. So us Northerners are great creators and innovators. But there is a challenge, however, and this information is stuff that no doubt you're all very familiar with. This graph actually shows how the economic output of the North compares with the economic output of the UK as a whole and London and the South East. And unfortunately, the red line on this chart is the economic output per head population here in the north of England. The black line is the average for the UK, and the silver line is London and the South East. And there is clearly a gap in this economic output. There have been a lot of clever people that studied the reasons why there is this gap in economic output, and there are a couple of key reasons. One is a skills gap, actually, and it's about education and training and getting people into work. But the second reason that sits behind this gap in economic output is the way that the economy of the North functions. The economy of London and the South East functions very much as a coherent economic whole, so people are able to move around that region for employment, businesses are able to trade with one another, and all of that enables the economy to thrive. And the reality is, in the North at the moment, we don't operate in the same coherent way. Our great towns and cities in the North, we don't have people moving from town to city for employment, and we don't have businesses trading with one another to the same extent that's enjoyed elsewhere in the UK. And that drives a big piece of that economic output gap. So to help put that right, frankly, the North needs one of these, a world-class transport network. And that is the vision that Transport for the North and Rail North have for transport here. And as the long-distance operator that connects all the principal towns and cities across the north of England, we've got tremendous responsibility responsibility to help create that over the next few years, and that's very much our ambition. So our vision for TransPennine Express is incredibly simple. It's taking the North further. This is meant to be read on two levels. The first is actually just the literal interpretation about taking our customers further on their journeys across the North. But secondly, it's speaking to our ambition as Northerners for economic growth and prosperity in our part of the world. And that's what the railways can help create. So our plan for realising the vision, very simply, it's about reimagining and transforming the offer we make to our customers. That's how we're going to make that vision a reality. And to help that vision become reality, we're delivering more than £500 million of fresh investment into our services over the next 4 years. The largest piece of that investment is in brand new state-of-the-art trains. And last year we signed contracts for three brand new fleets of trains that have now gone into production, and I'll say a little bit more about those. But they're going to be introduced onto our network, starting actually in Liverpool from spring next year, so not very far away. This is what one of the fleets of trains looks like. So this is the train that you'll be able to catch between Liverpool and Glasgow, and you've moved into a better launch. And here's another one of the trains that we're having built by Hitachi. And again, this train is going to serve Liverpool and connect Liverpool to Newcastle and up to Edinburgh, the East Coast Main Line. This train actually will be the most modern and technologically advanced train anywhere on the UK rail network at the point that it's introduced. So we're not investing in second-rate equipment. We've bought the best for our franchise, and for once we'll be able to say the North's got the most modern and advanced facilities for passengers to travel with. These trains are actually bi-mode trains, so that they can operate both with diesel-powered engines, but through overhead wires. They're capable actually of operating at speeds of 140 miles an hour. Now, the challenge we have right now is, unfortunately, the rail infrastructure doesn't allow trains to operate at that speed at this moment in time, but that's a challenge for the future. If we can persuade government and others to continue to invest in the infrastructure, there's a lot more potential that these trains can offer beyond their initial introduction. We're also going to be investing very heavily in our fleet of existing trains. I'll say a bit more about that later. All of that means we can bring many more seats onto our network. So across our network, there's 13 million more seats going to be available every year. We use a measure in our business called seat miles, which is the number of seats on our train multiplied by the miles they travel over. That figure is going up by 110% comparing today to the position we'll be in just over 2.5 years' time at the end of 2019. So that's more than doubling the capacity on our services, a huge expansion. And we're going to be able to offer faster journeys, so our trains are all going to be capable of speeds of at least 125 miles an hour, and that's going to allow us to slash journey times between towns and cities across the North. This is a little map, and apologies, the contrast is not so good on this presentation screen, which shows the network of services that we're intending to be delivering by the end of 2019. The key takeouts for Liverpool are that we are going to be delivering two trains an hour that go across the Pennines, across to Manchester, over the hill and over to Leeds. One of those trains will continue through to Scarborough. The other one goes through up to Newcastle, and we're planning to extend the service, which stops now in Newcastle at the East Coast Main Line to Edinburgh. So that will provide a direct connection between Merseyside and Edinburgh. And then the other new piece of news is on the West Coast Main Line, we're going to be launching a brand new service between Liverpool and Glasgow, two cities that have obviously got great historical cultural ties with one another, but for decades haven't had a direct rail service. So we're going to put in place that link for the first time in a great number of years, and we're tremendously hopeful that that's going to prove very popular with customers. In terms of the proposition on board, this is what the new trains look like inside. That's the first class saloon, that's the standard class saloon, so big transformation in the proposition. We're also investing in our stations, so we've got about £18 million that's being spent. This is a little schematic of the waiting facilities that we're having constructed right now at Manchester Airport Station, just to give you an example of the kind of modern facilities that we're looking to put in the stations that we manage. Our plan is one of growth, unashamedly. A couple of statistics for you. So right now, people that travel across the north of England on their long distance journeys, so this is journeys of more than an hour, one in three people right now are choosing to use the rail network to make that journey. That figure's gone up tremendously, actually, over the last 10 years in particular, to reach one in three. Here's the other statistic, though. Elsewhere in the UK, for long distance journeys, that figure's actually two in three. So there's tremendous headroom for the rail network here in the north to grow, for many more passengers to use those services and benefit from quicker connections between the towns and cities and all of the economic benefits that flow from that. So a year in, what have we been able to do so far? Well, our franchise agreement that we have with the Department of Transport and Rail North has a whole series of different, what we call franchise commitments that we have to deliver upon. 11 months in, we've delivered 125 of these separate commitments already. Some of these things are things that customers will have seen. So, for example, upgrading our onboard catering offer, making that available 7 days a week on board routes, through to things that benefit the environment, putting energy efficient measures into our stations, to ways in which we're working with Network Rail on delivering infrastructure improvements. So a whole range of different commitments there, and we're on track with that plan, 125 commitments delivered. The 27th of October last year was a significant date for us. That was when the first of our new trains went into production. In fact, this is the person doing the first bit of welding on the first of our new trains back then in October. We've been doing a lot of work with our manufacturers, CAP and Hitachi, to finalise the design of those trains, and we're now at the back end of all of that design review process, and that's enabled us to put trains into production. So this photo was taken 2 weeks ago, and this was the completion of the first outer body shell for the new carriages. And this picture was taken earlier on this week. It's been through the undercoat. So these train carriages are being built right now. We will see the first train sets going onto the test track this autumn in the Czech Republic, where they go for testing. And then they get shipped over to the UK early next year. We do some further testing on the UK rail network. But the first of the new train carriages are going to be conveying our passengers in spring next year, so a little over 12 months from now. I mentioned our existing fleet of trains that we use. We are investing very heavily in those. In fact, this year we're spending over £30 million to rip out all of the insides of those trains and to put a new specification inside that is very, very similar to that we're getting in our new trains. So this is our, for those of you that are familiar with them, our Class 185 trains. So they're the trains that we operate now between Liverpool and Manchester. This is the standard class saloon. This is the first class saloon on those trains. We've started that refurbishment program at the beginning of this year, and the first of these refitted trains are going to be carrying passengers in just a few weeks from now. And we're taking those trains out one by one, and we're going through the entire fleet to fit them out like this, and all of our existing trains are going to look like this by the start of next year. As well as the saloon environment, there's new services for passengers, so we're fitting free Wi-Fi on board for all passengers. For those of you that are Netflix subscribers at home, we're putting a proposition that's very, very similar to Netflix on board the train. So it's going to allow customers to stream the latest TV box sets, movies, news, straight to your iPhone, tablet or laptop while you're travelling. All of that's going to be free of charge for all of our passengers to use. That's going in all of our existing trains, and we'll be launching that service this year, and it will be in all of our new trains as well. So providing some new value-adding services for passengers while they're travelling. We're also investing very, very heavily in ticketing. modernising all of our ticketing infrastructure since we started the franchise, and that programme's continuing this year. One of the big features for us is around multimodal ticketing and how we join rail up with other modes of transport, whether that's buses, light rail, connections to airports, all of those sorts of things. So we've been doing a lot of work on this front. So back in the last year, we launched a brand new door-to-door multimodal journey planner. It's gone into our website and on our mobile app, which allows people to plan their bus connections into our services. And we're now working with other operators to integrate some of the ticketing so people can buy the end-to-end journey in one single transaction and receive that on their mobile phone instantly. There's a lot of work to do there. It's a very, very complex landscape of different operators, but we're working hard to make these improvements that will make it easier for the public to access public transport in the future. So that's a lot of the business transformation, but we appreciate that customers care very much about the here and now and what services are doing today and tomorrow. So I've got a few measures in this presentation. One measure that we use in the rail industry is something called PPM, or Public Performance Measure. So this monitors how many of our trains arrive on time according to their schedule. At the start of the TransPennine franchise, a little more than 10% of our train services didn't achieve that measure. We've been able to take more than 25% of the trains that were failing that measure to the right side of making them on time since we started the franchise. So we're actually making some great strides in punctuality and reliability. We've got a few challenges on our hands this week in particular because Liverpool Lime Street station unfortunately is closed, and we're having to terminate some of our train services at Liverpool Sound Parkway right now, which I appreciate is hugely disruptive for the public, but we're working very hard with Network Rail at the moment to see the line reopened hopefully at some point next week and allow the full restoration of our services. In the meantime, we're working very hard to try and get people to and from Liverpool Sound Parkway station so people can still continue to make their journeys. And actually, when I finish this presentation, we'll be heading over there just to check all the arrangements on the ground are working as well for the public as possible. We also look at customers' perception of our services. So Transport Foulkes survey rail passengers twice a year and ask them what they think of their services. They survey passengers of all rail companies to allow comparisons to be made. In the latest survey, our satisfaction rating has nudged up. It's gone up 1% compared to the same time last year. In the range of perception measures, the vast majority of them are showing year-on-year improvements. So we're making some steps in the right direction. The biggest challenge we have right now is one of capacity, which no doubt if you travel on our services, you might have witnessed some of that firsthand. And the new trains and some of the service expansion that I've talked about are going to be the route to solving that. A little bit on growth. We are growing as a business. In fact, we're growing faster than the rest of the UK rail market at this point in time. We're seeing good year-on-year increases in passenger numbers on all of our routes, including routes in and out of Liverpool. That's not necessarily the case nationally for the rail network, because there's been some downward pressure on rail demand caused by road fuel prices dropping compared to 2 or 3 years ago. But on our part of the network, we're still seeing growth in passenger numbers. And as more of this investment comes on stream, we're expecting that growth rate to increase further. So a little bit about the service expansion timeline and some of those improvements. We've had to do a little bit of reworking of the plan because Network Rail have published an amended plan for delivering some infrastructure improvements across the north of England. That's meant that we've had to rephase when we introduce some of our train services alongside the northern rail franchise to ensure that there weren't any gaps in service created by us making some changes, with gaps not being filled by Northern at the same time. So the first major change is going to come in May next year, where effectively we're going to be adding services across Pennines, and we'll be building upon that at the back end of next year, in December of next year, with the launch of our Liverpool Glasgow service. The final element of the change comes at the end of 2019, where the Liverpool to Newcastle service that we operate right now, we're planning to extend that up to Edinburgh, and that change will happen at the end of 2019. As part of all of this change, there are some changes to the stations that we're going to be serving across Merseyside. So our services next year are going to be both routed away from the Cheshire Lines onto the Chatmos route, which is the faster rail route between Liverpool and Manchester. So that means we won't be as TransPennine serving Warrington any longer, but we're planning to serve Newton and Willow station in its place to provide connectivity for people that live within that area. The other new piece of connectivity for Merseyside is that we are intending to serve St Helens, both once every hour on our services that go across the Pennines, across to Manchester, over to Leeds, but we're also planning to serve St Helens in our service that we've got from Liverpool to Glasgow. We're currently speaking to a range of stakeholders about which station in St Helens we should serve. There are a few different views around the table on that subject, but we're consulting at the moment before finalising which location we're going to serve. But we've allowed for it within our schedule, so that will be a new piece of connectivity to the TransPennine network. There are some other things on the horizon. So the government is going through a process to re-let the East Midlands trains franchise later on this year. That franchise provides some of the connectivity between Liverpool, Manchester and across to Sheffield. And as part of that re-letting process, we believe the government is going to consult on the option to remap some of those services out of the East Midlands trains franchise into the TransPennine franchise to allow a coordinated train plan to be delivered between Liverpool, Manchester and Manchester and Sheffield. Now that's not a decision that's being taken, it is merely a consultation, so the government will be inviting views from a whole range of stakeholders on that potential. We see that there were some things that we could do further above our original plan that would boost connectivity further, cut journey times further, and upgrade quality of service were that remapping to proceed. But obviously it's a choice that ultimately government is going to make, and I'll be interested to hear your views amongst those of others. So we believe that consultation will be coming out within the next few weeks. So just recapping on the timeline, all of this transformation is a four-year plan. We're a year into that plan, but all of those changes that I've described are on track to be delivered by the end of 2019, the transformation completed. So that was all I had to say in the presentation, but I'll be very happy to take any questions that any of you have got.
Thanks so much for that, Leo. That was really good, upbeat, showed lots of positive delivery so far, but obviously lots to come as well. I'm sure there'll be a number of people with questions, but I've got Terry first.
Yeah, thanks very much, Leo. Very, very comprehensive presentation. Can I ask that members about what we have? I'll just go over sort of some of the things that we've covered there. Is you talk about a world-class transport network,
yeah,
and we can see that you're endeavouring to try and deliver that. I think when you talk about the trains, is if you're going to deliver a first-class service, you've got to have first-class trains to do it, to get the passengers to come on. We welcome the new routes here on Merseyside, particularly here at Merseytravel, and we see yourselves as a very intricate and a very key part with regards to our partnerships. But also, as towns and cities, we see this as a potential for investment in towns and cities, and it's key to the growth of our towns and cities regarding the transport links that we've got. But it's also key in regards to who makes decisions as well. But I hope that the consultation that you're going to have doesn't limit it to just officers. I think it's very important that you talk to the politicians in regards regards to, particularly, and I will be parochial in regards to St. Anne's and where the station is there. But I also think that it's key in regards to accessibility, because we keep talking about transport links. It's not just about buses on their own and trains on their own. But it's important that we have an intricate transport link in regards to transport, in regards to buses and trains, and people getting off one to get on another and making sure that they're on time. But also in regards to where you actually stop is very important as well, because it's no good having a stop where it's not accessible and where it's going to and where you're not going to get the capacity for customer numbers. So I would ask you to sort of take that on board, if you would. The key to all this, and the key to all of it, and the key to successes of your routes is the customers themselves, and also the accessibility of the transport links. So I do think that if we're going to really do this, we get it right, there's massive potential for everyone in this room, not just in regards to the accessibility to other towns and cities, but also for our own towns and cities to make them more, give them a big potential to grow. So I welcome this, and thank you very much indeed. The last question I want to ask is, are you doing anything in regards to customers and people in regards to the potential for stations? Are you actually going and talking to any of the people who are actually using your routes at this moment in time in regards to accessibility?
As part of developing this plan, spoke to
microphone, please.
Spoke to thousands of our existing customers and also to potential customers, and we sought feedback as we were developing plans for the franchise. There are some other key touch points. So when we go through the major changes in our timetable, we go through a consultation process both with stakeholders but also with passenger representative groups. So that's another point of influence that's involved in shaping our service. And back on the earlier point about the location of the stop at St. Helens, we're very happy to come and talk to you and get your views on that subject. My colleague Lucia here looks after the Merseyside region in terms of our stakeholder dialogue. I'm sure Lucia would be really pleased to come speak to you about that. Thank you very much.
Got Ken and Gordon at the
pub. Thank you, John.
Thanks, Leo. It's excellent presentation, and let's hope your enthusiasm, which obviously you've displayed there, goes right down throughout the rest of your staff. It was superb, and of course you'll be linking up with, well, we get our new train set at Merseytravel as well, or Merseyrail as well, so we'll both have the most up-to-date trains in the country. Going back to what was said previously, we've got these new towns going to be built, or this type of thing, we've got new garden villages being built. How are you going to be able to work with Network Rail to link up these new towns that are going to do, you know, because you have to be completely flexible to do that, because it's obviously with Network Rail things take years to happen, to put new lines in. So I hope you've got a team looking at that. So as you know, it's connectivity again, is you're looking at that as a main thing.
In terms of the forward planning, we've actually built into our agreement with Railmore a series of what we call route studies. So this is looking actually beyond the plan that I've outlined, yeah, that takes us through to 2020, and some of those longer term opportunities. So we've committed to undertake a study for the route between the 2020 as part of our franchise agreement. We have started some work on that already, and some of that's informing some of the discussion that's going on at the moment about potentially the remapping of services between East Midlands Trains and TransPennine Express, but it will also take into account some of the spatial development in the region, whether that will demand a change in service patterns later on in the franchise.
Go on.
Thank you. just feel, and I'm not making any political comment that some of you don't need to look at, it's that across all the areas of the country, what's happened is the government has been reducing its investment in tourism marketing. What ideas have you got for increasing with the use of different groups and that, the revenue that you would bring in is affordable and will be able to reach new places?
We're actually investing £20 million over the first 3 years of our franchising marketing. You may well have seen some of our adverts on the TV or in the press over the last few weeks and months. But we've actually gone from a position. We do these street surveys to understand how many people are aware of our brand, the services that we offer, and where we go to, all of those sorts of things. And actually, in the last 12 months, that level of awareness has gone up very dramatically as a result of that marketing investment, and that's converting to more people that are travelling. So the promotion of the services is important, but the get the product right is also a big part of the plan.
Go.
Well,
I'm next,
and
then John.
Thanks for the presentation, Leo. It sounds really exciting and I look forward to see it all be on the road. I'm a wheelchair user, and what I did get from that was, will I be able to travel without having to get somebody to assist me on and off with a ramp? And how many wheelchair spaces do you expect to have on the trains? But also, you've probably been aware of the situation with buggies, children in buggies that sometimes they will take wheelchair spaces, so maybe you need to make sure there's enough spaces for people with their luggage and their buggies as well as wheelchair users. And on and off the train also, you talk about having better stations, so it includes making sure that the platforms and trains are level. So I was just wondering if you could say something about all of that, please.
Yeah, absolutely. So all of the new trains that we've ordered are fully accessible, so there are wheelchair spaces of the new trains. There's actually more provision than we've got on our current fleet of trains. And one of the things that makes this a lot easier, so we're going from three carriage trains up to five carriage trains, so that's meaning the whole range of passenger facilities that we're making available is better for both people that need accessible spaces and for other passengers as well. So there are designated wheelchair places and accessible toilets on all three of the new routes and trains. In terms of the access on and off the trains, there are some things that we're doing as part of the implementation of the new trains fleet. So we're doing some surveys at the moment to look at stepping distances between where the trains are going to be and where the platforms are going to be. One of the challenges we've got is the platforms across our network are all at different heights. So there isn't a one height fits all, so we can't design a train that is good for every single platform. So that means actually investing in the platform infrastructure to allow level access, and that can't be done, making sure that there are staff available to provide assistance to customers getting on and off the trains. All of our trains that we provide are staffed, and there are members of staff on board to assist people getting on and off that train service, so we're going to provide folks assistance. One of the other things we're doing at the moment in accessibility is we are working very, very hard on shortening that window for pre-booked assistance. So in the past, very often people that needed that extra help to get on and off the train had to book the day before travel. We're working with Northern at the moment to bring that time window right down and to make it available through a range of other channels, like for example the travel app that we've got for customers. So that'll allow people to make that pre-booking much closer to the time of travel. Your other point of question was around the buggies and wheelchairs. So we have, following the recent court case, actually provided some new guidance that's consistent with the outcome of our
88 station on the visitor on that road about how we can make sure that stepping distance is minimised and effectively we can have that level answer. We're more than happy to use that kind of information we've got from our project to share with you to see how we could sort of potentially get accessibility right across the country. Okay, I've got John and then Tony.
Thanks, Chair. Leo, thank you very much for your presentation. Clearly, it's not under your purview or area of responsibility to actually address the skills gap, but we mustn't underestimate the importance of that because that is huge in the north. But clearly, it's under your influence to be able to produce a world-class system, which you are actually making inroads on that. So, thank you very much for that. Just my question is, I just wonder how closely you're working in conjunction with the government and other train operators to actually produce a holistic overall plan for the north.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, one of the major developments is the formation of Transport for the North and Rail North, and that devolution of responsibility to the North of England means that we can work more closely together in a more speedy and responsive way than perhaps we have been able to in the past. So, the old contract, the TransPennine, was managed from London, a team based in Whitehall. We've now got a management team that's based here in the north of England who we're speaking to on a daily basis about the delivery of our commitments and how we can continue to add and build to that plan. So that change in governance is hugely important. In terms of that sort of cooperation with other rail operators, our biggest single interface is actually with North Rail. We've got the most sort of overlaps between service and staffing and all of those sorts of things. We've entered into what we call a Concord agreement, so a whole series of areas where we're collaborating to make sure that the passenger experience is as joined up as possible. Some of that includes some of the accessibility issues that I was referring to earlier, but it includes other things around staffing and stations so that customers get a joined up answer to questions they might have and any of that sort of assistance requirements. So we're working far more closely with them under this new contract, and having both franchises managed locally in the north is a huge help.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Our proposition involves the retention of second safety critical member of the staff on our trains. That's our method of operation for our franchise. So conductors will be dispatching our services in the future on new trains. So that's our plan. So we're perhaps not caught up so heavily in some of the issues that are facing other operators at this point in time.
I think it's probably important just to note the difference that your services go hundreds of miles, whereas some of those other services only go sort of tens of miles. Yeah. And obviously, you're calling it a number of unstaffed stations, which
right.
Isn't the case in other parts of the north.
Yeah, that's absolutely right.
I was going to ask a couple of questions as well, one of which you've already answered, but I'll just kind of make the point accordingly. Really pleased to see you focusing on the remapping potential. Of the Liverpool Norwich service from East Midlands Trains, because whilst that service is probably much better than it was in the days of Central Trains, we still do quite often feel that we're at the end of the route of what is actually got, not just a vital intercity service for Liverpool, linking us with Manchester, Sheffield and Nottingham and beyond. It's actually a vital intercity service for Widnes, and it provides the intercity train that Widnes gets at this moment in time. So I think from our perspective, we'd be very, very supportive of that proposition, because that as a service that fits your portfolio very, very nice. So we're more than happy to work with you on that basis and sort of support that proposition. The other question I was going to ask, which is slightly away from TransPennine Express, but I'll ask it and I'll tell you why. I think you're part of the first group of TransPennine Express. I think it's fair to previous franchisor were able to develop more services as part of that, as the Dublin frequency into Liverpool. And as we've seen, you're already starting.